When you grow up in a musical family, as I did, it never occurs to you not to be a musician. As part of the family activities, you sing and dance together. No, really, that's what we do. And as you grow older, you find your own path. For me, it's the piano. It's become my musical voice. At some point, as you go deeper into this musical world, you typically learn and become conversant in the formal language of your preferred music. This is true of classical musical systems worldwide. You learn the symbol system of your preferred music. These symbols convey musical concepts and practices of your preferred music. They also make it possible to preserve musical creations for the ages and to transfer musical ideas to other musicians. So as a result of this kind of process, the musical score, that written document, has become extremely important. And musicians who know how to read music are highly valued. Whether it's the shakuhachi tradition of Japan, or the Carnatic musical system of South India, or Gregorian chant, Beethoven, movie music, patriotic songs. The musical score makes it possible to recreate a musical experience anytime, anywhere. As a result, most of our music arrives to us ready-made. Ready-made for our consumption, our entertainment, our enlightenment. We are typically passive consumers of ready-made music delivered to us by musicians who are literate in that musical system. But there's another world of music where the emphasis is on doing it. Everyone doing it. Let's go there.
They're virtually yours for being a Homo sapien.
We know this because new research has focused on infants and babies. Let's stick right now with rhythmic entrainment. Here's a baby, just being balanced, listening to a drum track. She can't get enough of this. What this kind of research has shown us is that our brains are beautifully wired for music. This is not a right brain, left brain world. The music receptors in your brain are all over your brain, regardless of your preferred music. So this raises a question. If all of this is innate, we're all pre-wired for music, what about other species? Let's stick with rhythmic entrainment for the moment. Here's Snowball! And they spend 6 months creating the seasonal song together. Then they go silent for 6 months while they go to the feeding grounds. When they resume singing 6 months later, they start with last year's seasonal song. Pitch discrimination, musical memory. So what does all this mean? I work in a field called biomusic, which studies musical brains and musical capacities in all species, because your ability to interact with others and with your environment is dependent on these musical capacities. They also forecast your ability to survive and to get along. Let's think about being together with our fellow human beings. Where would marching, singing together, dancing, team sports, even cheerleading be without rhythmic entrainment? In a conversation with another person, all speech doesn't have to come to a grinding halt of silence for the other person to begin speaking. No. The uptake of that conversation by the other person happens at that natural rhythmic moment that has just flowed from you. This kind of conversational turn-taking is rhythmical, and your brain does it automatically. Think about how you're entrained with yourself. When you're walking, your arms naturally, rhythmically entrain to your walk. And if you're gesturing while you speak, your gestures automatically entrain to your stress and tempo of your speech. Rhythmic entraining. As far as pitch discrimination is concerned, in this whole room of cell phones, you all know what your ringtones sound like. And we could all break out right now in a chorus of happy birthday because of our musical memory. All of these scenarios are supported by a magnificent musical communication system that resides within us and around us. And what we're finding in this research is that we're not alone, that these musical capacities are embedded deeply in the wild. Furthermore, these musical capacities are primal. This has really profound implications for our species and for other species. I'm engaged in sound mapping the Mesoamerican reef. We're dropping hydrophones at the second largest reef system in the world because vision is not your best tool in the ocean. We're capturing the sounds of the animals that live at the reef and migrate by the reef. And we're learning in a whole new way how they interact with each other and with their environment. Returning to our species, new therapies are being developed that use this magnificent musical system in our brain to reprogram damaged brains. So by using music making, we can actually recapture lost abilities due to stroke or traumatic brain injury. And when it comes to interventions, we have new interventions that use music making in combination with hand-eye coordination to stimulate and increase learning. Going forward into the future, we want to continue to expand our understanding of this fabulous music communication system and to learn better how to use it to our advantage. So in the future, we will design sound environments that support wellness. We will design sound environments that are prescriptive and individualized that support healing. We will manage the sound environments that will preserve and protect other species. Consider that new technology is now on the drawing board that is going to be able to record the sounds of individual cells within your body. That means that we can use patterns of sound and time to listen to cells that are healthy versus cells that are diseased. This opens up the possibilities for us to have a diagnostic tool that's non-invasive, that listens to the body and pinpoints diseased cells. And it may be possible to write a code of sound waves to neutralize those diseased cells. You should also know that NASA has already sent recordings of human music making and whale songs into intergalactic space. With the possibility that extraterrestrial intelligent life will know us by these sounds, creating the possibility that the first communication with an ET may actually be a musical communication. With all this said, perhaps we should reconsider the importance of music making in our lives and the role that it plays with educating and mentoring our children. Because they're going to need heightened musical capacities to be able to walk into these new careers and jobs. Music is not just a leisure activity. It's a potent communication system that is embedded in the wild and that connects all of life on the planet. So, embrace your musicality. Experience this world as a musical place. And know that the future holds a robust and fast musical conversation. Thank you.